And hi YouTube, welcome to this video. So we are again doing, we're continuing the thermal boundary layer analysis. So as usual, we actually stopped at this part where we sort of figured out the thermal boundary layer equations, and I'm just copying and pasting it here. Of course, for revision, I'm just putting back the mass and momentum balance equations for the momentum boundary layers. Of course, if it's a steady state, then we'll get rid of the time derivative terms, no problem. Okay, so what are we supposed to do? Okay, if you want a solution procedures. My goodness, my pronunciation is so procedures. My pronunciation isn't at its top today. Solution procedure. We have the similarity solution, or Blasius style type of solution. We also have a von Karman style solution. This is a integral solution. This is a von Karman style. And last but not least, and of course, a von Karman style is more widely applicable, but the best is just use a computational fluid dynamics, or more likely multi-physics simulation. Okay, we use discretization and we just plug these things into a computer. We hope that it will solve. So again, OpenFOAM console and a whole suite of other programs can be used to solve these boundary layer equations. Because CFD is the most widely applicable, but you got to learn how to do it correctly. And this can be sort of a sanity check. We like to call it a sanity check, in a sense that, hey, how do you know your CFD solution is correct? So you can benchmark it against either one of these solutions. In fact, similarity solution, again, is the gold standard. We like to call it the gold standard. Okay. Everything else is more or less A. This one maybe is called a silver standard. This one's really up to you, how you make it. All right, so let's take a look at the similarity solution again. Okay. The similarity solution is as follows. Let's just copy and paste this down. Okay. Section. Back to similarity solution. So this is how the similarity solution looks like, with the appropriate boundary conditions, of course. And then the first thing we want to note is this. Okay, we want to take a look at this equations. All right. In case of no pressure gradient, right? Okay. In case of no pressure gradient and non-dimensionalizing. Okay, in case of no pressure gradient, right? We have this del p del x term just drop to zero. Okay, del p del y of course equals to zero, which is not saying very much. Okay, pressure seems to be constant, unless of course there's a gravity term, then of course the pressure is just hydrostatic, more or less. Okay, if you want to take a look at I'm going to get rid of the y solution, and I'm going to get rid of the pressure term. So I'll put zero. Okay, I want to make an observation about something. Now, if you want to see this equation and this equation, they look very, very similar. Okay, they look very, very similar. However, there are some problems. For example, this alpha here, which is thermal diffusivity, that's not the same as momentum diffusivity. Okay, one of the ways. Okay, let me just continue something. One of the ways to solve this thermal boundary layer solution is something called the Reynolds analogy, which takes advantage of the fact that these two equations look so similar, so that might as well just use what we already worked out, right? The similarity solution here, we have worked it out for the Blasius equation. Why not let's use it exactly, copy and paste over to this thermal boundary layer. I mean, we can do that, right? So, the first way we can think of is called the Reynolds analogy. So, we can say, hey, these equations look so similar. So let's copy paste the solution. Okay, under certain constraints, of course. And what's the constraint? The main constraint is that nu equals to alpha. This is the constraint that must be obeyed. Okay, it must be followed. Or the other way is, well, you know the thing called Prandtl number. We like to use it a lot in heat transfer. And since this actually pops up so often, we actually give it a non-dimensional number. Okay, Prandtl number is nu over alpha. So let's look for Prandtl number. Named after Ludwig Prandtl. He's a German physicist. He is a physicist. Okay, according to Wikipedia, anyway. Yeah, the most reliable source in the world. Ha ha ha. Okay, Prandtl number, nu over alpha. Momentum diffusivity, which is the kinematic viscosity, over thermal diffusivity. So it's how fast the momentum spreads versus how fast the temperature differences also spread, or temperature spreads, so to speak. Okay, so Prandtl number must be equal to 1. And if you want to swap these things around, if you want to change up the equations, okay, we'll notice that alpha equals to nu over Prandtl number. Okay, so alpha equals to nu over Prandtl number. So this makes life a little bit easier. Okay, so if Prandtl number equals to 1, then we'll have this first transformation. We can just leave nu here, which is the first part in making these two equations look almost identical. So if we can make those two equations look identical, we can just copy and paste the solutions over. All right, so now second thing is that let's introduce in the non-dimensionalization. All right, let's introduce in non-dimensionalization. Okay, first we use the relative temperature trick and change the variable to theta. Now, if you watched the last video, we found out that when we did this whole process, we can actually just replace t here with theta. Okay, we can just replace t with theta. Okay, so this is the non-dimensionalized temperature. Okay, and if this is the case, and we look at the momentum, equation, if we non-dimensionalize the momentum equation, at least partially, okay, we can just add a u star. We can add a u star to all of these because, well, u equals u star u infinity, right? Let's do it like that. Okay, so that's the first thing. U equals to u star infinity. U infinity. I do it for the terms inside, not the terms outside, right? That one is just to show you how similar they are. So now I can cancel out all the u infinity because that is a constant. Alright. Okay, so u star and theta. Okay. So what does this mean? Okay, we already proved we can reduce the equations as follows. Okay, the momentum boundary layer equations as follows. We reduced it to this f prime kind of a term. Okay, we reduce our momentum boundary layer equations using this non-dimensionalized string functions. Again, if you're not sure about this, you can go and take a look at my fluid mechanics playlist. I already showed you how to derive this equation, so I'm not going to go through it again. Now, the thing is, if this is the case, alright, we can actually, if we take a look at this and this, right, we reduce this equation into this form, this f prime, f triple prime, all that. Then, if we take a look at this, if we take a look at this equation, and we look at the non-dimensional temperature and non-dimensional velocity, we see, oh man, these look almost interchangeable because every term on the outside is the same. Okay, so they obey the same partial differential equation. We already showed that we can reduce this momentum boundary layer equation into this form, and we note that we can set theta equals to u star. Okay, we can set theta equals to u star. Alright. We can set theta in equals to u star because these two equations, they are pretty much identical under the condition that the Prandtl number is 1. And this whole idea is called the Reynolds analogy. Okay, so let's take a look where this all leads to, right? Okay, so let's go back the non-dimensional part. We see that u equals to u infinity f prime over 2. Okay, so I'm not really doing anything new. I'm just adapting whatever was present into this. Okay. Okay, note that u equals u infinity over 2 f prime. Or in other words, u star equals to fraction f prime over 2. Now, depending on how you derive the original equations, whether you use a factor of 2 or not, your numbers will be slightly different and your solutions will also be slightly different. But the idea, the concept is the same. We like to use u star equals to f prime over 2. Okay, and since u star equals to f prime over 2 under Reynolds analogy, we can say, okay, theta equals to f prime over 2 also, because we see that they obey the same partial differential equation, because we set u star equals to theta, and we do that because these two equations look pretty much the same. So now we can pretty much adapt the Blasius solution to thermal boundary layer. So this is called Reynolds analogy. Under Prandtl number equals to 1. So we didn't really have to do much extra work here. We just I'm trying to show you that you can reduce this to the same form. Okay? So, okay, you have this result, so what? And assume that you know f prime already, because f prime, when you solve it, you will have a whole table of f prime values. Okay, that one you use your own Runge-Kutta code or whatever it is to solve this equation with the boundary conditions here, with this same boundary conditions. And of course, you got to make sure the boundary conditions are the same for both the thermal boundary layer and the momentum boundary layer. Meaning to say, does it make sense? Hopefully it makes sense. The non-dimensional temperature difference, okay? Let's see. The whole thing should be the same at u star equals to, okay, the premise is that u star equals to theta at all points. Okay, so let's look at some boundary conditions. Okay, so u star is u over u infinity. Okay, and at the surface you expect u star equals to 0. Okay, and the free stream u star equals to 1 in the free stream. Okay, so does it check out? U star equals to 0 at the plate, flat plate, which is a no slip condition, perfectly fine. U star equals to 1 in free stream, which is a free stream condition. U infinity over u infinity equals to 1. Now let's take a look at the non-dimensional temperature as well. So at y equals to 0, theta equals to, again, by definition, T over TS over T infinity minus TS. Okay, and here, of course, the temperature here is equal to TS. So theta equals to 0 here. And what about in the free stream? Theta equals to, again, T minus TS over T infinity minus TS. And since temperature here is T infinity, the top side will just be T infinity minus TS over T infinity minus TS. And this is equal to 1 as Y becomes large. Okay, so based on this, you can see that the boundary conditions are more or less set up the same way. Okay, so we assume, okay, assumption, the other assumption is this. Okay, we assume that the non-dimensional temperature profile and non-dimensional boundary layer profile and BCs, boundary conditions, are exactly equal. Okay, so this is very, very, very important assumption. And I just gave you a rough intuition to say why they must be the same, or why they should be the same. Yeah, I'm almost finishing, so okay, so that is good. And then based on that, what can we do? Based on that, we can get the temperature profile and heat flux. So these are the most important. Okay, based on this non-dimensional temperature profile, we already pretty much have it. Okay. So theta equals F prime over 2. That's a non-dimensional temperature profile. So if you want the temperature profile, you just make sure you have F prime over 2 at anywhere you want. And you just get T minus Ts and T infinity minus Ts. That's your temperature profile. Okay, very simple. Okay, as long as you have a table of F prime and you solve these equations, you just apply it to the thermal boundary layer, should be fine. Okay, and of course there, if you have Prandtl number equals 1, and that means your momentum boundary layer thickness and your thermal boundary layer thickness are the same, because theta equals to U star in the Reynolds analogy. Okay, so now what if you want heat flux, right? What about heat flux? So after this, I will call it a day. Okay, so heat flux. So heat flux is Q at the boundary. At the boundary, it's actually equals to partial T, partial Y. Right? Partial T, partial Y. So this is how we find heat flux. Okay, but one need to note, how there's something very similar. We have a del U del Y here, right? Okay, note. So this is basically using what the Blasius solution is. Tau X equals to, or rather, partial fraction, partial U partial Y equals to what? Fraction U infinity over 4 fraction, okay, there's a square root, because I'm just you looking at du dy term. Okay, so square root, square root fraction U infinity U nu x, okay, F double prime. And what does this mean? You take a look at this over here. Okay, take a look at this over here. And we try to shift this, force this to become like U star, right? So U equals to U star U infinity, so we can actually cancel out one of them. So I'm using this result here to try and force this to get a result from here, so you can get some heat flux. So U infinity will drop, and then we'll have a 1 over 4 there, and you have this F double prime. Okay, I didn't like derive this properly, I mean even in the previous videos, but this is one of the results. If you can go and check out, you can do the derivatives yourself. Okay, but I'm saying that if we have this result, we can actually change it into something that helps us to determine the heat flux. So this is del U star del Y. Okay, del U star del Y. And we said that U star equals to U infinity, right? Under Reynolds analogy. Or U star equals to theta, sorry. U star equals to theta here. Alright. So I can just copy and paste theta in at minimal effort. Okay, so under Reynolds analogy, U star equals to theta. So del theta del Y is what you need for heat flux. Okay, and what do you have here? Here you have some sort of a semblance of a Reynolds number. Okay, where actually Reynolds number is UX over nu. So we will need to change things up a bit. Okay, so we have x squared at the bottom and ux on top. Because I want to get a Reynolds number out here. So u infinite, we have a Reynolds number over here. And then we can bring x squared out of the thing, and inside will just be the Reynolds number with respect to x. So fraction 1 over x. All right. All right, so thankfully, we can just substitute all of this in. Okay, del theta del y. Of course, we want to change that up into t minus t s. All right, and on the right hand side, I will have t infinity minus t s. Minus t s. Alright, so once we have that, we can just shift this over. We can actually get rid of Ts since it's a constant. And now we have a del t del y. Then let's get an expression for a heat flux in terms of f prime anyway, or f double prime. So you can just copy and paste this whole thing inside. Okay, I'm almost done. So we do have an expression for heat flux. So we do have an expression for heat flux. Okay. And then of course we can get a Nusselt number from that as well. But take a look at this. We more or less have it here. We can put the x at the bottom, k over x. Okay, so heat transfer coefficient and Nusselt number is a good thing to know. Oh, I'm again almost at 30. Okay, but let's just finish this up. Okay, let's do a heat transfer coefficient, which is H. Okay, or Q. Okay, Q as such. Okay, Q equals minus H T S minus T infinity. Right. So this is the heat transfer coefficient. You can substitute. And we'll find that the minus signs cancel very nicely for us. So let's cancel the minus signs. And we can get rid of the Ts minus T infinity. Oh dear, why did I just leave a... Okay, so anyway, do take note of the directions, but Yeah, do take note of the directions. I think it's still better to do it like so. Because you have a T infinity minus TS over here. So anyway, yeah, the minus sign should be as follows. Sorry. The minus signs always mess me up, so do pardon me. Okay, so my goodness, what's going on? Line 415. All right, there you go. Yeah, just know that h must be like a positive value. H is a positive value. It doesn't take into account like the directionality, so to speak, so you don't have to worry about the minus signs. So anyway, h is as follows. Then you have 1 over 4 or f double prime over 4. And you notice that the Nusselt number will just come out. Okay, hx over k. Okay, define nu x is equivalent to hx over k. This is the Nusselt number. Okay, which is a dimensionless sort of heat transfer coefficient or something like that. Or one the other way of thinking about it is the ratio of the boundary layer thickness to the ratio of the characteristic length scale of a system. But to the way I like to think about it is the more Nusselt number you have, the better your heat transfer. That's a very good metric to think about through all systems. Okay, so though of course the heat transfer coefficient itself will do that. So this one kind of takes in the length scales, relative length scales as well. Okay. Define Nus no. Define Nusselt number. Okay. Okay, so NUX is equal. Okay, so I bring the x on top, k at the bottom. So for the Reynolds analogy case, it's equal to f double prime over 4 square root RE x. And it's a very, very simple solution. Okay, here Prandtl number is 1. It becomes really, really easy. Okay, so what is the value of f double prime? Okay, I look at the textbook or solve it yourself. That Blasius equation, yeah, the Blasius equation, you should be able to solve it using the boundary condition. And then you will get this f double prime, okay? F double prime equals to 1.3. Yeah, 1.3 something 28. Okay, f double prime equals 1.328 at y equals 0. So because we are looking at wall heat flux, right? We're not interested in heat flux in other places. 1.328. So 1.328 over 4. And that's will be equal to okay. Let's just do some quick maths. 1.328 over 4. LibreOffice, what is it? Okay, 0.332. So 0.332 square root RE x. And that is basically the Reynolds analogy, where Prandtl number is 1, and you can see that the equation gets solved very quickly because it has been solved before. Okay, 1.328. Okay, so 1.328, you can just substitute in here. So this thing you have to take a look from a table. Either you calculate it, you solve the Blasius solution yourself, or you I mean take a look at how someone else solved the Blasius solution and you get it. Okay? Of course, your tables will be slightly different depending on how your P ODE will look like for the Blasius solution, but the end result should look like this. Okay, this is a textbook answer, so to speak. All right, so hopefully this gives you an idea of what the Raynaud's analogy is. And I'll see you guys again. Bye-bye.